Jiten, you also mentioned the security aspect in terms of tackling security threats like screen hijacking. Do share some tips and applications for parents to ensure online safety of their wards.
Well, we've been running a lot of cyber safety courses for children and parents in last 4 or 5 years. But of late, we're seeing an increasing demand from teachers to understand those things. Because, you know, you would be surprised to know that the kind of complaints we are receiving, more than the children and parents, it is teachers who have been bullied. So, you know, the fine barriers of talking something about after the class or the back of teacher, those fine lines are being blurred, and there are people who are writing random, I would say, you know, bullying messages within the chat room while the class is going on, and all the children are seeing. So teachers are, you know, facing a very different type of pressure and stigma, and they have nowhere to go. There are a lot of child helplines which are running. There are a lot of helplines which help parents to deal with their, you know, child bullying and stuff, cyber bullying. But there is no one to help teachers. So, you know, one of the things I would recommend to all the schools that, you know, please get all your teachers to attend some, you know, online or some guy, call some guy to attend at least a couple of our workshop how to deal with this online education and the challenges. So I think educating teachers today are more important, and parents are more important than, you know, taking safe educating children and other things. Then there are other things like, you know, when you give online assignments or when you do online evaluation or when you conduct any sort of online examination, there are a whole bunch of other challenges. So I think instead of spending money on those things, it is better to go for open book exams.
All right. So that's actually a very pertinent point that you've made. I'll actually like to bring in Amita also, since you mentioned teachers being bullied online. Amita, we are all aware that online learning is not just about speaking into the microphone at one end and connecting a laptop and listening in on the other. It has its limitations too. Since Jiten also mentioned about teachers, how challenging has it been for the teachers in terms of communicating with students, not to forget online bullying?
You see, as a school, we have always been very involved in competency-based education and personalized learning. And so the entire online platform, we've converted into breakout rooms, into conversations, into very small modules, children doing the presentations, children essentially working on peer learning. So, you know, we've never really had this whole idea of just sitting there and transacting learning or doing a you know, just sort of reading out of the textbook. So there have been some very interesting games, there's been dances, there's been music, there's been a constant flurry of activities within the learning system. So, you know, the bringing in the whole 21st century learning skills, ensuring that children take the ownership of learning. Mm-hmm. So when you create learning capsules in that fashion, then what happens is that there's no time for getting on with it and harassing somebody, because, you know, you are reaching the mindset and the heart sets of children. And so as far as we're concerned, I think we've given a lot of importance to teacher and child engagement, personalized conversations, coming together in breakout rooms, being able to talk about it. In fact, there are so many days we don't teach. We just sit and have conversations. What are you feeling like? The whole feeling idea of coming out, the whole fact that the emotions have to be engaged with. And so when you take on that kind of attitude towards the classroom in which you are bringing in a learning system, I think the children become very close to you, because as it is, they're exhausted by being limited in these four rooms with a couple of adults who they're, well, in a certain, to be captivated by or captured by, not captivated, but captured in a certain sense, for so many months. And they have no other outlet. So the Fair teacher enough. Then becomes, and the peer becomes an interesting sort of circle of confidence for them.
Absolutely.
So I think that's what is necessary.
Right. It is the teacher-student relationship which has to be reinvented and redefined. Michael, what will be the new criteria for a child's examination, and how challenging will it be in terms of value assessment? Do we now need new policies for a new education model?
Yeah, I think absolutely. I mean, look, what we just heard there, personalized and competency-based, I think are exactly the way we need to move as we start to capture students' learning. And what we ought to be looking at as for each individual student, rather than having one exam that they sit for at the end of the year or at the end of a certain number of years to see do they make the cut or don't they make the cut or how much do they get wrong and so forth. How do we move assessment to be a much more continuous? Yeah, I think absolutely. I mean, look, what we just heard there, personalized and competency-based, I think are exactly the way we need to move as we start to capture students' learning. And what we ought to be looking at as for each individual student, rather than having one exam that they sit for at the end of the year or at the end of a certain number of years to see do they make the cut or don't they make the cut or how much do they get wrong and so forth. How do we move assessment to be a much more continuous operation that is combined with the learning to give teachers and parents and the students themselves the insights on how that they're doing, and that allows them to constantly be mastering and focusing on what they need to do next for their learning, and thereby creating a transparent record of this is what I've mastered, this is what I've really been good at, this is what I've dove deeper in, this is where I've accelerated and done more, that's almost real time, if you will, that gives a much, that takes away the high stakes nature and instead encourages a development of every single child into who they're meant to be.
Right. Amita, would you like to add anything to what just Michael said? And should e-learning be treated as a temporary measure, or should it become part of the education policy?
No, it should become. In fact, the National Education Policy has made it very clear that the digitalization of our country and the digitalization of learning is very essential, because it's very good for tracking students' records. It's very good for having learning anytime, anywhere. It's very good for children doing personalized learning, and for them not having an information overload, but being able to sift what they would like to learn and have innumerable courses they can do. So I think e-learning has to be blended, but there is absolutely no compensation for a school of brick and mortar. So there has to be an interesting mix between the two, as I always said that, because ultimately schools are about what? They're far beyond learning. They're about companionship. They're about freedom. They're about peer relationships. They're about character building. They're about self-esteem. But even these aspects you can bring into e-learning through bringing in values through the skills that you teach. So I think it's very essential that we are able to blend the two aspects of learning, a hybrid, and make it a sort of a holistic 360-degree kind of learning system. And that's what the future is. And
fair
it should
enough.
Be.